Gold at record prices makes hard rock mining sound like the logical next step. If gold is sitting there locked in quartz, surely that's more reliable than chasing flakes down a creek. Surely that's where the real money is. That idea has launched more failed mining attempts than almost anything else in modern prospecting, and this is where the reality gets uncomfortable very quickly. This video is based on legislation and on-ground realities in Victoria, Australia, but almost everything discussed here applies globally. Different countries and states tweak the details, but the core problems are geological, physical, legal, and economic, and those don't change just because the rules are written differently. Before anything else, we need to make one important distinction. For this video, we're talking about the best case hard rock scenario, a gold-bearing quartz vein that sheds free-milling gold, not refractory gold. Refractory ore is a completely different conversation. It's not impossible to work on a small scale, but it dramatically increases cost, complexity, chemical handling, and risk to a point that it deserves its own dedicated video. If you want that breakdown, leave a comment, because it's an entire topic by itself. So let's say you find a hard rock gold vein and it's free milling. That's already beating the odds. The first question people rarely ask but absolutely should is whether the gold grade is consistent throughout the vein. Most of the time it isn't. Quartz veins are notorious for being wildly variable. One section might carry visible gold, while the next few meters are completely barren. High-grade pockets can exist right next to worthless quartz. That means you're not mining a uniform resource. You're selectively chasing zones of enrichment, often with no obvious visual boundary between good rock and bad rock. The next question is what kind of vein you're dealing with. Is it a proper reef that's several feet wide, or is it a narrow stringer? Most discoveries made by individuals are stringers. Thin veins, sometimes only centimeters thick, cutting through country rock. Stringers can be incredibly rich, but richness alone doesn't make them viable. You have to ask how much material you can realistically extract that will actually shed gold once crushed. If the gold is confined to a narrow band, you're spending enormous effort for very little tonnage. You don't get paid in grade alone. You get paid in recovered gold per unit of effort. Hard rock mining immediately introduces something alluvial prospecting largely avoids: machinery dependence. You cannot economically crush hard quartz with hand tools at any meaningful scale. A mortar and pestle is fine for samples, not production. You need a reliable crusher capable of processing large volumes quickly. Crushers are expensive, heavy, noisy, and require maintenance. They break, they wear, they consume power. Suddenly, you're not just a prospector, you're a small-scale industrial operator, whether you intended to be or not. Then comes gold size. Is the gold coarse enough for gravity separation, or is it fine? Fine gold in hard rock ore is far more problematic than most people expect. Gravity systems work best when gold is liberated and coarse enough to respond predictably. If the gold is too fine, much of it will simply pass through your recovery system unnoticed. At that point, gravity isn't enough and you're pushing towards chemical processing. That means leaching, precipitation, cleanup, waste handling, and safety considerations. The moment chemicals enter the equation, the cost, risk, and regulatory burden increase dramatically. Contaminants make this even worse. Minerals like stibnite can effectively swallow gold, preventing it from melting cleanly even if you recover it. Sulfides introduce another layer of complexity. Gold locked in sulfides cannot be treated the same way as clean quartz gold. Traditionally, roasting was used to oxidize sulfides and liberate gold, but roasting releases toxic vapors that are hazardous to you and anyone nearby. In most modern contexts, it's simply not acceptable or safe to do without proper infrastructure and controls. This is one of the points where small-scale hard rock mining quietly collapses under its own weight. Now step away from processing and look at logistics. How far is the reef from your vehicle? This sounds trivial until you're doing it every day. Ore is heavy. Quartz is unforgiving. Every meter between the vein and your car translates directly into lost energy and lost time. How much ore can you realistically carry per day without destroying your body? And remember, this isn't a one-off effort. This is daily repetitive labor. In Victoria, and in many places around the world, you're also restricted to hand tools only. No explosives, no mechanical excavation, no powered breaking of rock in situ. That means hammer and chisel, wedges, hand drills, and sheer persistence. It's slow, physically punishing work. Protective equipment is not optional. Silicosis is a real and serious risk when breaking quartz. Eye protection is mandatory if you value your eyesight. Gloves, respirator, and proper handling practices become part of your daily routine, not an occasional precaution. Depth limits are another hard stop. In Victoria, under recreational permissions, you are effectively limited to about 1 meter below natural ground level, and all holes must be backfilled. You cannot sink a shaft, you cannot chase the vein underground, you cannot follow ore chutes downward like the old timers did. That means you're restricted to shallow surface expressions of a system that almost always improves with depth. Many hard rock gold systems are vertically zoned. The best material may sit well below what you're legally allowed to reach. This is where the romantic image of hard rock mining collides head-on with modern reality. The old timers didn't stop at a meter because the gold ran out. They stopped because of water, timbering, cost, or danger. Today, you stop because the law tells you to. That doesn't mean the gold is gone. It means it's inaccessible to you. Another factor people rarely think through is selectivity versus waste. When you're breaking rock by hand, you're constantly deciding what to keep and what to leave. Take too much waste and you exhaust yourself processing barren material. Be too selective and you risk leaving gold behind. Those decisions compound over time, and mistakes don't show up immediately. They show up weeks later when you realize the return doesn't justify the effort. Then there's the question of time. Hard rock mining is slow, crushing is slow, processing is slow, and cleanup is slow. Even in best case scenarios, production rates are low compared to the effort invested. This makes hard rock mining far less forgiving than alluvial prospecting. Alluvial gold can give you quick feedback. Hard rock gold often delays feedback until long after the work is done. There's also the legal transition problem. The moment you want to go beyond surface sampling, you're no longer talking about recreational prospecting. You're talking about mining licenses, work plans, environmental approvals, landholder agreements, rehabilitation bonds, and compliance. That transition is expensive, time-consuming, and uncertain. Many people discover gold, but very few successfully navigate the leap from discovery to legal extraction. Psychologically, hard rock mining is brutal in its own way. You can work for days or weeks breaking rock and see nothing tangible until the final processing stage. That delayed gratification amplifies doubt. It's one thing to pan a creek and see gold daily. It's another to trust that hundreds of kilograms of rock will eventually justify themselves. And yet, despite all of this, hard rock mining still holds enormous appeal. When it works, it can be spectacular. A genuinely rich, free-milling quartz vein can produce gold far more consistently than most alluvial systems. The gold is often cleaner. The system feels more real as a resource. For some people, that sense of permanence and control is deeply attractive. But the key word there is some. Hard rock mining is not a natural extension of alluvial prospecting. It's a different discipline entirely, with different risks, different costs, and different failure modes. Most people underestimate how quickly those factors stack up. This video isn't about telling you not to try. It's about making sure you understand what you're stepping into. High gold prices don't remove geological complexity. They don't remove legal limits, and they don't remove physics. They just make the question louder. In the next video, we'll look at metal detecting as a full-time pursuit, where the barriers are lower, the feedback is faster, but the competition and randomness increase dramatically. Each path into gold has its own reality. Hard rock mining just happens to be one of the least forgiving if you go in unprepared. Gold doesn't reward optimism, it rewards understanding. I hope you found this as interesting as I did, and as always, thanks for watching. Before I end this video, I'd like to give a big shout out to my Patreon and YouTube members. Thank you so much to everyone that helps to support this channel.